The only thing that actually changed was our veil.
Sister Joanna has been a Carmelite for 49 years, and she's happy her order didn't go to extremes after Vatican II.
But good Bishop Sheen, he said too, he says, how many left their convents and left their communities to do social work? He says, where are they now?
The Carmelites' renewed constitutions were approved by the Sacred Congregation for Religious and Secular Institutes on July 24, 1984. Some religious communities are shrinking, closing facilities, and selling off property, but not the Carmelites of the Divine Heart of Jesus. As they enter the second century of their apostolic work, they find themselves on the cutting edge of the world's problems with increasing demands for their services.
When you think of all the broken homes today, the children running the streets, they're becoming delinquent, they're hung up on drugs and alcohol, and even young girls are picked up at 15 years of age for prostitution. I mean, we are here for that kind of work. Those children, we need it. We are needed for that kind of work. Those children need us.
That's a voice of experience. Some 40 years of working with girls and boys in trouble in the Northern Province. In Latin America, the Carmelites live and work in the trying and turbulent settings of open warfare, bloodshed, poverty, and unrest. In Nicaragua,
yes, we have many fears, but that doesn't mean that we have no confidence. So this hope, we have to show the people that there is a God.
We had two homes in Nicaragua, this Managua and Bluefield, and one in South America, in Maracaibo, Venezuela.
In Venezuela, the Carmelites work mainly
with the poor people and the mission, the children, and also we have a health center for the poor.
We had a kindergarten for poor people, for children. We had a dispensary, and we work with young people for in the shore, with catechism.
We have already vocations. In 7 years, we have already two girls from Venezuela.
In Mexico, Carmelites and lay people from California are busy with a mission in Tijuana, caring for the poor children and their mothers.
We teach the children catechism, and their parents also, they're instructed.
In Eastern Europe, the Carmelites were in the midst of the dramatic, sweeping changes of 1989 and 90. Starting in Hungary, where the government declared itself independent and opened its borders, a tidal wave of humanity brought an end to decades of repression and religious persecution. Hungary relaxed its restrictions on religion. From Holland, the Carmelites sent a delegation headed by former Superior General Mother Siegfrieda.
And they went to the bishop and asked, would it be possible for the sisters to begin to wear the religious habit again? And permission was gladly given.
The Hungarian sisters quickly fashioned a tiny chapel, and a month later, the auxiliary bishop celebrated the Eucharist. And from that day on, the Hungarian Carmelites had the Blessed Sacrament in their midst again. So for the first time in 40 years, the sisters were allowed to wear their habits, and of even more significance.
But what is so important and what we are so grateful for is that these sisters over all these years have remained faithful to the religious life.
Whether in Europe, Latin America, the United States, or Canada, these women of compassion have carried out their apostolic work under the most trying circumstances. Nearly 600 women make up the Carmelite family at the centennial point in the order's history. More than 50 of them are postulants and novices, and the order needs more.
I believe every congregation and every province needs more sisters.
In Corpus Christi, the Carmelites are holding weekend retreats for girls and young women, showing them the work the nuns do and their lifestyle, and it's bringing plenty of girls to the retreats.
They are very surprised about this. They have never experienced anything like this, and it's quite different from their mode of life naturally. Mm-hmm. So it's a challenge.
God's call to the Carmelite life of prayer and service is being heard despite all the distractions of the world.
He spoke to me through the scriptures, and I was growing up with all the rock bands and music too, but sometimes you just have to get away from these things and materialism and things, you know, pretty much those things that attract our youth today.
I went visit many congregations that I know I like. My heart is in the Carmel.
God just kind of reached down into my life and and call me to him in a very, I feel it's a very special way, very special.
I became a Catholic at 18 and entered the convent at 21, so I really wasn't sure what to expect. I just knew that I wanted to give my life serving the Lord.
But why do the Carmelites have to wear such old-fashioned habits or religious garb? Can't they be women of compassion and dress more modern?
And this is like a testimony, a witness that we belong to God, and this is our future hope in the resurrection, that there is something more than just this life.
Joy and happiness radiate from the sisters in whatever setting they live and work. For this documentary, we visited Carmelites in poor inner city settings and in suburban locations. Everywhere we went, we asked the sisters, are you happy? And would you become a Carmelite again if you had to do it all over again?
Never had thought to go back to my home. So I'm always happy.
I've never been happier in my life. Each day is more and more rewarding.
Very happy. I wouldn't give up my life for anything.
can't see myself doing anything else.
I think this is one of the greatest apostolates that a young woman could have today, and it's a great need in our time.
Our prayer is the fruit of our apostolate. It all goes together. It's one. It works as one. So I love working with the children.
And during more than 60 years as a Carmelite, did Sister Adelaide ever want to run away?
No, I never wanted to. I was happy, very happy.
Sister Adelaide and the other retired Carmelites live in special quarters or the infirmaries of their mother houses, where they get plenty of tender, loving care. But most Carmelites don't retire early. They're happy with their work, even in their advancing years.
Very much so, yes. And I'm waiting now to go pretty soon to heaven, maybe. And my job is over.
Sister Lucy is still very active as the superior of the Carmelite Home for Boys in Hammond, Indiana. That inner joy and happiness from their work keeps the Carmelites looking young.
And I think being around the little children, it really keeps you even younger. Because when I go home, nobody can believe that actually that I'm still here. And number two, they can't believe that I think I'm going to be 39 pretty soon. And they say I don't look it, but sometimes I feel it. Because it is a challenge to keep up with these little five-year-olds. It really is. But I enjoy it very much.
When God calls the sisters to eternity, they're buried in their own cemeteries at Sittard or in the provinces. Mother Foundress' original gravesite is still marked outside, even though her remains are now inside a chapel. On her tombstone is the inscription in German, and translated it reads, Mother, we thank thee. Mother, we follow thee. Her followers look hopefully to the future. In addition to more vocations, the Carmelites are praying for the canonization of their foundress.
And I believe her message to women at large is no different than her messages to us religious women, and that is simply to be the givers and to give the best we have to give to the world and to our neighbor, which is Jesus. I believe we have to be other Marys. We have to bring God, bring Christ back to the world.